loudly until I know that this is going to be on. So just to tell you a little bit about the previous piece you just heard, Aurora is the Roman goddess of the dawn. And if anything, you've certainly heard kind of a growing optimism and a brightness about the piece. And if you're an 80s music aficionado like myself, you may have recognized a particular lick that happened in the percussion. I'll tell you a little bit about what just Mackie actually wrote about this piece. The first of the quotes, there's actually two quotes in this, which appears at the beginning of the second section, is an ostinato based on the familiar guitar introduction to U2's Where the Streets Have No Name. The strains of the Edge's guitar have been metamorphosized into an insistent repetition of keyboard percussion, and aesthetic is similar, a distant proclamation that grows steadily in fervor. The difference between U2's presentation and Mackie's, however, is that the guitar riff disappears for the majority of the song, while in Aurora Awakes, the motive persists nearly for the entirety of the remainder of the piece. He writes, "When I heard that song on the radio last winter, I thought it was kind of a shame that he only uses that little motive almost as a throwaway bookend. It's my favorite part of the song, so why not try to write an entire piece that uses that little hint of minimalism as its base?" And then if you are a band geek, perhaps like myself, or you played a lot of band music, you might notice that very last chord, which is actually almost exactly the same as Gustav Holst's last chord of the chaconne in the first suite E-flat. And he writes this: "This has always been one of my favorite chords because it's just so bright. In a piece that's about the awakening of the goddess of dawn, you need a bright ending. And there is no topping Holst, well, except to add Protolix." So that's this particular piece, which is just honestly a lot of fun to play. Oh, yay! We have more sound, and I don't have to, it's Hill, so I can project pretty well, but it's nice to have a microphone. About this next piece, which is kind of taking us back a bit, this piece is called Cathedrals. It's by Kathryn Salfelder, who's written quite a few pieces for her band, and we're certainly thankful for her voice in our medium. Cathedrals is a fantasy on Gabrielli's Canzoni Primi Toni from the Sacra Symphony, which dates from 1597. Written for St. Mark's Cathedral in Venice, the canzone is scored for two brass choirs, each comprised of two trumpets and two trombones. The choirs are stationed in opposite balconies of the church, according to the antiphonal principle of broken choirs, which forms the basis of much of Gabrielli's writing. So this is why you see two different choirs going on stage right now. Cathedrals is an adventure in neo-Renaissance music in its seating arrangement, antiphonal qualities, 16th century counterpoint, and canonic textures. Its form is structured on the golden ratio, and if you don't know what that is, you can Google it later, which is commonly found not only in nature and art, but also in the motets and masses of the Renaissance composers such as Palestrina and Lassus. The work is a synthesis of old and new, evoking the mystery and allure of Gabrielli's spatial music, intertwined with rich color palette, modal harmonies, and textures of woodwinds and percussions. So this is Kathryn Salfelder's Cathedrals.